Everyone, it's Alex, and this is definitely a video. So initially this video was supposed to be something like my favorite love stories or my favorite romances, but I realized with the books that I read, it doesn't even have to necessarily be about the effectiveness of a love story or a romance for me to really enjoy it. But maybe more importantly, I do realize that the pattern of the books I like that may have romance in it is usually a pattern of being, unfortunately, toxic. Overall being for me that I think an effective story with this kind of stuff in it is being able to see beyond the two characters' relationship as the main point, but clearly at the same time where I indulge in stories where men are being awful. So I took it upon myself to have some suggestions for you right in time for Valentine's Day for some book recommendations that I personally feel fit into these three tiers of romance-esque books that I made categories for. So let's start off with tier three, which is haha, what would you do if I was there? Winky face. So sometimes with these books, they have male characters that are some of my favorite in being that I can easily overlook them and that they are forgettable. These characters felt often one-dimensional to me and maybe some like use as being a prop for the main character to maximize their potential. Yet oddly, the book tried to feel formulaic by integrating romance that to me felt unfazing, ineffective, and made me even worse, uninvested. So overall, with reading these books, these characters felt good for one thing only, and that is to be a plot device. So for me, I feel like if I want a male character to hurt me, at least hurt me in an interesting way. Up first, we have Swimming in the Dark by Tomasz Jedrowski, which takes place in Poland in the 1980s. This book is about two characters, Ludwig and Janusz, and it's from Ludwig's perspective from living in New York City at the time, but he's reflecting on the past in Poland whenever he met Janusz. And with Janusz being the offender here, I just found him to have no appeal. The book engages the story of trying to have this meet-cute moment, but it really became the backbone of the story, mainly because Ludwig found Janusz partially, like a part of this being attractive, is that Janusz was reading Giovanni's Room by James Baldwin, which is clearly code for gay. But later the book does morph into this political backdrop of Poland in the 1980s as sexuality, especially between same-sex couples, is very frowned upon, even legally. And between the growing descriptions of this power imbalance based on sexuality of the time, as well as Jedrowski's prose, I feel, confusing, flowery language for sentimentality, none of it was really working for me, and I unfortunately found it kind of a snooze. Up next, we have Lie With Me by Philippe Besson. This story is about a man named Philippe, who is a writer who is recounting his memories with a past lover named Tomasz. Philippe is certainly no expert at his growing sexuality at the time, as he realizes he has feelings for Tomasz, but Tomasz at the same time, refreshingly, is no expert either. But in Tomasz's case, he's on this list because I found him to be a bit too of a removed, brooding presence in Philippe's life without feeling really a part of it or dynamic, and not even what I felt like was in an intentional way. That narratively just made me find Tomasz to be more boring than mysterious, as Tomasz is sort of used as a gateway of Philippe realizing that sexuality, even between two people sort of getting to know their sexuality at the same time, is a spectrum within itself. And while all of that is nice and good, I just found the romance or the love story here not very believable. And the reason Tomasz is primarily on this list is because there's one part whenever he literally tells Philippe he's not like other boys, making Lie With Me a merciless manic pixie story. Alright, so now we're on to tier two, which is Pass Me the Ox Cord. So with tier two, we're getting a little more interesting because I feel like these are men who are still awful, but I feel like there's some narrative justice as to why. That to me, I found them more redeemable in the story because I feel like they go beyond being stand-ins for gestures of trying to divorce a character's own autonomy. So in a way, these characters fool me because I'm impressed by their initial desire for connection, and I'm also impressed by their confidence in shape-shifting the structure of romance between themselves and the main character. So basically what I'm trying to say is that these are characters I would keep around, but I absolutely know they are not good for me, but I would be endeared by them as people. And up first we have Nikolai from War and Peace, and I feel like War and Peace needs no introduction, but just in case you need one. The book tells a wonderful story between a handful of characters during the French invasion of Russia in 1812. And one of those handful of characters is Nikolai, who is this epitome of the boyish, 20-something that's also, like, oblivious to everything. Whether it's literally gambling away all of his money one night, or literally confused why someone would try to kill him in combat, or the icing on the cake for me being that the reason Nikolai is on this list is because he literally promises to marry someone, and that girl convinces there's divine intervention of why they should get married. Also, quick plug to say that War and Peace, I feel like in its own way, is super underrated because people, I feel like, think it's like long and boring, but it's really wonderful. Tolstoy never wastes time with starting a story, so I love reading his work. So Nikolai's on here less for my personal feelings about him, but I just love his effectiveness in the story, adding some levity and boyish charm, especially with how he interacts with the character Sonia, and therefore with Sonia as being a character who I can intellectually describe as someone that is a simp. Up next, we have Julian from Exciting Times by Nisha Dolan. Exciting Times is about 20-something Ava who's in China teaching kids English. While Ava's there, she has a on and off thing with a guy named Julian who has so much aux cord energy because he knows exactly what Ava wants and what her desires are and basically what she's thinking. Ava even admits this by saying that she wishes she had the mentality of Julian with relationships, as coming off as so effortless and not confusing. With Ava's particular interest in this idea of a power balance especially, so whenever it comes to times where Ava finds out, for example, that Julian also writes poetry, it really sort of breaks the facade or illusion of Julian being this idea in her head versus a fully fledged person. So like Ava, even if I were to get secondhand embarrassment from Julian writing poetry, Julian makes it on this list because I would hate that he's sometimes right about me, and then he's a clear communicator too, so sounds like a nightmare. Up next, I have Heracles from Autobiography of Red by Anne Carson. This is actually a novel told in verse, and it's based on a Greek myth retelling on Geryon and Heracles. In mythology, Geryon is this red-winged monster who herds cattle, but Geryon really serves as the background character to Heracles' story, as Heracles comes by and shoots Geryon in the head with an arrow. So Anne Carson's retelling of this is based on the idea between Heracles and Geryon being lovers from teens into their young adulthood, as Geryon still maintains his monstrous appearance and ways, but also takes up a hobby of photography. And with the novel being told in verse, it does feel like it has this medley of feeling from Geryon describing his emotions, but there's also delicate restraint to Carson's prose that does make the book feel serious, but in a very good way. And so that Heracles' appearances in Geryon's life do feel like this welcomed respite to everything going on. Even though Heracles is absolutely not good for Geryon on top of other things in his life, so if a man ever comes up to you and says, "Hey, you look cold," and then puts your hands inside of his shirt, run. So we've now made it to our final tier, and these are the biggest offenders, and the tier is called Kyle from Lady Bird. So these characters are like top tier stuff. They just give me absolute tunnel vision that I absolutely just get complete, like, all the red flags that ever existed in the world, but I would still consciously, like, get to know these characters if they were real people. But to make this about books for a second, I really do love how these characters are observed and described based on the crusher projecting onto the crushee, creating this very one-sided pining that I just love to read in stories, while also acknowledging that the whole story isn't dependent on the backbone of this inner story. So up first, we have Henry Tony from Northanger Abbey by Jane Austen. I can't believe I'm already getting defensive about my own list, because Henry Tony does not deserve to be on this list at all. He is not a bad guy at all, but that's exactly why he's on this list. Henry Tony is the leading man in Austen's Northanger Abbey, and in my opinion, is the most underrated Austen leading man. He is kind, respectful, charming, and clever, and enjoys witty banter. And it feels appropriate because Northanger Abbey is all about being a love letter to stories, so it makes sense that Henry feels like this amazing bachelor. And Northanger Abbey probably has one of my favorite moments in fiction based on our heroine, Catherine Morland. Catherine is someone that loves books and stories and really has her head in the clouds, even crafting this wild theory that Henry's father killed his mother. And she literally goes on to tell him this, so that is a very offensive thought to entertain. Of course, Henry being Henry, he is still as kind and polite as ever in response, and that's why I hate him. The last thing I need is some tall, well-mannered, dark, curly-headed, 20-something-year-old dressed in Regency clothing to come into my life and mess it up. And yes, I have watched the Northanger adaptation with J.J. Fields, and it is correct. So runner-up for tier one is Yvonne from The Idiot by Elif Botman. This book is about a girl named Celine who is at her first year at Harvard in the 1990s. And really, now that I think about it, I think The Idiot is my favorite contemporary novel. Celine is super into linguistics, and in one of her classes, she meets Yvonne. Yvonne is super into math, and he also finds Celine's intellectual curiosity really endearing, so the two begin to exchange emails. And here is where Botman is really an expert at articulating this sense of pining and doubt and all the impressions that come from reading too much into something like an email that your crush sends you. And with Celine finding this connection between herself and Yvonne fascinating, she even goes as far as to traveling to another country because Yvonne has interest in doing so too. But what's amazing is that The Idiot really transplants these skills from a student at an Ivy League school by demonstrating skills like doing a critical deep dive into why you like a crush, while also having an experience between leaving a bubble like school, or in Celine's case, also her identity as a Turkish American, by traveling elsewhere and also realizing that growing into young adulthood is so subjective. And what's better to start off your young adulthood than realizing people like Yvonne are either good for you or bad for you? And it's amazing reading Celine as a character being inside her thoughts, based on either wanting to tell Yvonne off, but also being submissive to this deadpan humor that Botman writes so well. And it's that humor that becomes so frustrating, because I really do think Yvonne is like this kindred spirit to Celine, where I really think they make sense as being like people that should have met in their lives. So as I was reading this book and also feeling like Celine, I had to remind myself on multiple occasions to resist stanning Yvonne. And the number one spot for this video would have to go to the all-time offender, and that is Nino from the My Brilliant Friend series. My Brilliant Friend is a series that spans four books describing the friendship between two girls named Elena and Leela. And wedged between them sometimes is Nino. All three of them grew up together in their neighborhood in Naples, Italy, but I don't want to confuse anyone by describing this series as being about this romance, because it really isn't the point of the whole thing. But Nino's presence in how Elena Greco, who's our narrator, describes her life is so commanding, and just with Nino really coming off the page as this passionate, young, intellectually curious guy that wants to flee Naples just like Elena does. And I think it's how Ferrante really mixes together the confusion between the ambitions of wanting to have aspirations at all for a romance that is so fascinating to read about between these three characters. But the problem is that Nino is not as considerate or generous of thinking of the bigger picture, as he's just consumed by everything within his passion that has no direction. He's nearly written in this villainous sort of description, but Ferrante never makes it easy to pigeonhole characters into any soul archetype, making me, as cheesy as it sounds, sort of catching my breath whenever I find out Nino just reappears sometimes in Elena and Leela's life. And to top it all off, the HBO series so far of My Brilliant Friend is truly chef's kiss, as the show really captures all the hesitation, seduction, pining, and pain of a bunch of stupid teens going into adulthood. So yeah, that wraps up whatever this video was. And personally speaking, of course, I would love to know your own take on this theme of this video. But regardless, I do think each of these books do have their own value in reading them beyond any love story or romance, so I hope you consider checking them out as well. As always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.